So we are starting with chapter 2, and that is called as Information Systems and IT Fundamentals. If the first chapter was boring because of management, business, process, theory, then second chapter will be super boring. Because in this particular chapter, I will be talking only about the concepts of information technology. But I'll try my best to make this lecture very interesting by incorporating the right examples wherever it is required. So before we begin our journey, okay? Once again, the name of the chapter, it is Information Systems. That is completely intangible. And Information Technology, obviously it is tangible. So let's start with the very first question. What is the need of information technology in today's business world? Again, I repeat, a request from my end, close your books. See, if you want to keep your module open, then why are you coming for a lecture? You can read it at home also, na? Keep it closed. Half time you'll be reading the module, half time you'll be hearing. When you want to read it, you should be just reading it, and that is at home. Now keep all your books closed, just listen to what I'm saying. I'm starting with the very first question, the need of information technology. Why is information technology required? I started my first lecture by saying the same thing. You see computers everywhere. You go anywhere, you go everywhere, and you'll be seeing computers. And that particular explanation was nothing but the answer for this question, the need of information technology. But that was, I was talking about each and everything, but each and everything won't come in this answer. We need to have some channelized answer, proper wordings, proper points, and only proper concepts. So I'm starting with the first need of information technology, and that is called as communication capabilities. The first one I'm talking about is communication capabilities. Now in today's world, communication is the key. We need to communicate with each other. People at same level communicate with each other. The higher level management communicates with the lower level management. The lower level management communicates with the higher level management. The employees of an organization communicates with the outsiders. And the outsiders also require to communicate with the insiders. So communication is everywhere. I mean to say, shareholders ask some queries to the board of directors. It is outsiders to insiders. The board of directors gives information to the other parties, that is insiders to outsiders, and so on. Okay, and you will see a drastic change in the business of today's corporates. And that is, they are expanding. They like to expand. They like to grow. I need not go very far. I am talking about MT Educare. I'm talking about MT Educare. Now, MT Educare is a company. It's a public limited company who originated in Mumbai. There's a place in Mumbai called as Mulund. And there it started its class. It went on expanding, and today we are having 32 branches of only commerce, many more of science, many more of school section. I'm not very sure, but it is around 200 just in Mumbai. That's the expansion I'm talking about. But the journey didn't end over there. We have now branches in Gujarat, in Baroda we have, in Ahmedabad we have, in Rajkot we have. Coming to Chennai, okay, mother branch, Mandevli, Nungambakkam. Then in Nungambakkam, once again, there are two branches. This is Rosie Tower. No, this is? And then Rosie Towers. 2 years before, we were having branch at Annanagar and T Nagar. That was closed and this branch was started. So that is called as expansion. We are now in Mangalore also. We have our own university in Mangalore. So this is nothing but expansion. But whenever we are doing expansion, tell me whether the accounts will be maintained separately at separate branches, at separate areas. No, they need to be consolidated. And I told you, MT Educare is a public limited company. So finalization of accounts is important. I mean to say it is necessary. So will you be preparing final accounts for Mumbai, final accounts for Chennai, final accounts for Gujarat? Is it so? All information at all the places has to be brought together. And if you want to bring together information, obviously the people working at different branches have to communicate with each other. Yes or no? And that is the need of computers. Computers are required in communication. Now, MT Educare is a very small company. If I talk about the Tatas and the Ambanis, okay, this company is small before them, right? Now, we are growing in India, but these companies are all over India. Plus, they are in other countries also. Just think the quantum of communication they might be doing, the communication that they are requiring. So just by sending letters and sending the musters by courier and books of accounts by courier won't help. We need some super fast technology, and in layman's language it is called as computers. So we require computers for effective communication, quick communication, fast communication, effective communication. Am I right or wrong? Hey, good morning. Get up. Okay. You want to wash your face? That's nothing but the effective communication, fast communication. Now, there are various means of communication. Whenever we are talking about communication with the help of computers, there are various ways of doing it. See, if I say communication, then in old sense or normal traditional one, we can send letters, we can make a trunk call, then we can send a pigeon kabutar for sending messages and so on. But whenever we are talking about information technology as a means of communication, I need to make a special mention of email. Achha, everyone knows what is an email? With the help of internet, we can send messages to n number of people. You can compose the message, you can have a subject, you can have CC, BCC. Most important thing is you can have attachment, you can send it to n number of people and whatnot. I don't want to discuss more on emails. So email is one of the way. The next way is video conferencing. See, email, I call it as passive. Because when I'm drafting the mail, that person who is the authorized recipient might not be knowing that I am supposed to receive an email. He must be busy somewhere. When the mail reaches him and when he'll be opening his inbox, then only he'll come to know that I have received a mail. He will read it, he will reply it, then I'll come to know that I have received the mail. So it is passive. If we want faster means of communication, we should be very, very active. Active means we should sit face to face and communicate, but that is not possible. So video conferencing is the right method so that we can have a active communication. We are sitting face to face, no doubt about it, but it is virtually. Virtually, na? We are sitting face to face, no doubt, but it is virtual. That person might be, say, 5,000 kilometers away from me. But it feels like we are having a cup of tea together. And that is nothing but the importance or the need of information technology in communication. There was an era when people were doing time pass on Yahoo Messenger and MSN Messengers. There were chat rooms, virtual chat room obviously. And people used to log in that chat room. Okay, and then find some good person to whom you can communicate and go on chit-chatting. No common subject, just go on chit-chatting. A method of doing time pass. Today also, these chat rooms are being used. But we are not talking to a person who is unknown to us. It's within the organization. All the employees is given a proper ID and they are the authorized personnel to enter in a chat room. And then we can have a discussion. So it is quite obvious the discussion will be only about the betterment of the company or about the company, if not betterment. That is nothing but a chat room. This is one more way of communicating with the help of internet. And the most important is Skype, right? People stay far away from each other, but it is because of Skype they don't miss them. There are many people who are working abroad, obviously, for earning fast money, right? They stay away from their family for months together, many a times for years together. How can you stay away from your family member, authorized family member, authenticated family member I am talking about? So Skype helps. Skype helps. Okay. Normally, when I come to Chennai, I stay for 6 days, max to max 7 days. But this is for the first time I'm away from my home for almost 11 days. And it is taking a toll on me. So this time I decided that I'll be installing Skype on my laptop. And then I can communicate with my family. So after the lecture finishes off in Mandivali, I talk with my family members for half an hour. I feel better. Okay. And the next day, I can start with great enthusiasm. But if this was not, then I would be very lonely. Hey, good morning. What we did in the first lecture? Acha, we need to start the second lecture. No, such things don't happen. Okay. And that's because of Skype. Let's talk something technical of Skype. Skype, everyone knows it. But on internet, it is also known as Voice Over Internet Protocol. It's called as VOIP service, that is Voice Over Internet Protocol. It is that protocol which is supporting the flow of data in the form of audio and video. And last but not the least, which I don't want to discuss, is WhatsApp Messenger. And I have told a lot, I have cursed a lot this WhatsApp Messenger. Okay, so with the help of WhatsApp Messenger, you can almost, you're almost online every time of the day, right? A mail comes, you can receive it immediately. If you want to post some message, you can put it immediately. All these things can be done immediately. That's nothing but the WhatsApp Messenger. This is the importance of information technology for communication, effective communication, fast and quick, quick communication. And also, the cost involved in all these things is also less. Next part is the data and information management. We all know it's the duty of the organization to protect our assets. Property is assets. Vehicles are assets. Machinery is assets. Stock are assets. Computers that are used are assets, but I am talking about the intangible assets. The data of my customers is assets for me. The data of the suppliers of the goods is assets for me. Those people who provide me services for efficient working of the business is assets for me. So it is very important that I should be maintaining these assets, and all these things comes under data and information management. I need to manage the data, I need to manage the information. Today, this data is not stored in physical form. See, there are huge companies. Every day, thousands of transactions take place. Thousands of documents are being filed. And if I want to store all these documents, just imagine how much real estate I would require. I don't know what are the property rates in Chennai, but I can surely tell you about Mumbai. In Mumbai, the property rates is around 1,20,000 rupees per square feet. And I'm talking about residential rates. Huh? These are not commercial rates. Just think what the commercial rates would be. Now this is the rate of that place where Mukesh Ambani resides. It's a road called as Nepenthe Road. It is just in front of the sea. You must have seen photo of Mukesh Ambani's residence. His residence is called as Antilla. And we have a branch just situated in the next road of Antilla. There is a station called as Grand Road. For the first time, I had a lecture over there. I got down to the station and I was looking at that building. I have seen this building somewhere. But I was not able to recall. I am coming for the first time over here. Then how I have seen this building? Now after 2 or 3 hours, I realized, this is Mukesh Ambani's residence. And I am very near to it. Now, if I am storing the data, obviously I will require some commercial property. And if I start spending on buying commercial property or just renting out commercial property, just think how much money I am spending. The other way is, you can have what? You can store the data in digital format. Digital format means you'll be storing the data on computers, on hard disks, on secondary storage devices. And today, the new concept has come up. It is just a year old, and that is called as cloud storage. Internet is providing you with the facility of storage. You need not buy big servers. In layman's language, you can rent a server. You can rent a server, and that is called as cloud storage. But whenever we are talking about data and information management, protecting the data becomes important and protecting the data becomes difficult. Suppose there is some important data in this book. I don't want anyone to access this data. What I'll be doing is, I'll put this inside Godrej safe. Triple locking system, electronic system, no one can access it. No matter how big hacker he is, he will not able to access this. Because this is not online, it is so simple. He can access the data which is online, na? Or this is not online data, he cannot access it. Now who will access it? A thief. But a person who is a thief, okay, what he will do of this data? He will try to steal gold, diamond, something like that, which is very precious. This is just papers. What it is for him? Nothing. But I cannot afford to do that. So I am having my data on computers in digital format. And now anyone can access that data which is digital. So it becomes my responsibility to protect this data. How to protect this data? And the right answer is, I'll be having access rights. I will be having access rights. What is access rights? Access right means giving access to only those people who are authorized for it. You will decide who can access my data. Let's say Ram Prakash is engaged and he is having some communication with his fiancée. Okay, obviously it is a, say, chatting transaction. He is saying something, she is saying something. He is saying something, she is saying something. Okay, now this went on for half an hour and they both signed out. But because Ram Prakash is feeling lonely, what he has done is, he has converted that entire conversation into a text file. And whenever he feels bored, whenever he feels lonely, whenever he comes in the lecture, he's just reading it. Oh, so. Please calm down. But now, Ram Prakash, tell me, don't you think you will not like to share all these things with others? Okay, but tomorrow, if Satya accesses that information and if he starts, he will enjoy it, that's for sure. But will you like it? This is personal information, personal conversation. So, Satya is an unauthorized person to see that information. And he is not authenticated, he is not authorized, he will not be allowed to access that data. Tomorrow, he meets his fiancé and then he shows his fiancé. See, when I am alone now, okay, I feel very lonely. So this is what I do. Now she is the authorized recipient. So she will be allowed the access, and this term is called as access rights. You give it to someone so that they can access the data. You restrict someone so that they won't access that data. Understanding? Now, the next thing is, in access rights, you have different levels. You have different levels. Like say, for example, Ram Prakash, who is your one best friend? Be fast and quick, don't waste time. Who? Sharad. So Sharad is his best friend. So Ram Prakash might share that information with Sharad. It's not compulsory. He might share, but there might be some sentences that Ram Prakash would not like to disclose. Like there will be M-U-U-U-U-H, M-U-U-U-U-H. I don't know whether you are understanding or not. Now these lines, these lines he would not like to share. So this is, hello. This is called as having access right for different levels. Now he is sharing the data with Sharad, but that is called as partial access. Some part of the data can be shown, but some part will not be shown. That is called as access rights. Now, we need to protect our data from those people who are outsiders, like maybe hackers. Hackers are always interested in disturbing others. They are interested in disturbing. They won't gain anything from it, but they are happy disturbing others, hackers. Some are hired hackers. Your competitor might hire them for taking your data, for knowing your data, or for destroying your data, so that you will lag behind in competition, and they might take over the business from you, or they might lead the business. So we need to have information security so that we can stop the misuse of the data, plus we can stop hacking of the data. And this can be done with the help of passwords and encryption of the data. Everyone knows what is a password. Everyone knows what is an encryption, but they don't know how exactly encryption is being done. So when the right time will come, I'll teach you how exactly encryption is done. I'll teach you the process of encryption. That's the second application or need of information technology, that is data and information management. Okay, before we start with the third one, let's welcome our latecomers. And the last point for the need of information technology is the automated process. And we have been learning about automated process in that entire first chapter. The process of business has to be automated. We have learned something called as business process automation to save the cost, to save the time, and to save the efforts of the people of the organization. So that's nothing but the need of information technology. We are now moving to the next question, that is, explain the role of information technology in auditing, or what are the points to be considered of auditing in an IT environment. Before I start with auditing in IT environment, let me tell you something about auditing. Actually speaking, it is not required because you can tell me better what is auditing. No? Okay. Auditing is the physical verification of all the documents of a company. It starts with the physical verification. It is also called as vouching and verification. A financial transaction starts when a basic document is generated. I have a desire of purchasing the goods. I went to a store, bought the goods, made the payment. Obviously, I'll be asking for bill. And even if I'm not asking for a bill, they are recording that particular transaction. And from here starts accounts. Then that will be converted into journal. Then a journal entry will be posted in ledgers. Then ledgers will be closed. The closing balance will be transferred to trial balance. From there, adjustments will be there. And at last, final accounts will be done. Am I right or wrong? But whatever entries do appear in the final accounts, the validation of those entries are required to be checked. And so we put our vehicle in the reverse gear. We go back to the trial balance. We go back to the ledgers. We go back to the journals. We go back till that actual document which was prepared at the time the transaction took place. That is nothing but auditing. Auditing is about evaluating the transactions in the business and then preparing a report. And this report is required to be given to the top management. It is often said, I don't know whether you know or not, it is often said that auditor is the watchdog of the company. He sees to it that everything that is happening in the organization is according to the wishes of the top level management, or it should comply to some law. And I know only one law regarding company. It is Indian Companies Act 1956. And I know there are n number of amendments which were made in different years. I cannot name that year, but still some amendments are being done. So reporting is being done to the top level management so that they are ensured. They can make sure that everything that is happening in the organization is according to the law, is according to the provisions made in the law, and according to the provisions made in the memorandum of association and the articles of association of the company. For that, auditing is required. Audit involves some system controls. Now, system controls refers to installing proper controls in the system, like who can access the data, how much data can be accessed by them, when that data can be accessed, who are allowed to input data. See, those people who are allowed to input data, they are not allowed to access data. Who are you? An accountant, na? A clerk, na? So you need not access other information of the company. Your work is to feed information, do that, take salary, that's it. Am I right or wrong? That's nothing but the proper control. A person of marketing department has to do nothing with what is happening in purchases. You do your job. That's nothing but the system controls. Every person should be doing those things which he is asked to do, or which he is authorized to do, or for which he is appointed. That is called as installing proper system controls. Auditing in IT environment is done so that auditing can be an efficient process. It can be an economical process and it can be an effective process. Why audit is done? That objective should be achieved quick, efficient, fast, and at a lesser price. One of the main purposes of auditing is to safeguard the assets and information about an organization. Assets means I am referring to both the assets, tangible as well as intangible. Protecting the assets means whatever is the value of machinery that is given in the books of accounts, is it really that much amount? That's how we are protecting the assets. And we have information about n number of people, about n number of things in our company. We have information about our employees. We have information about our shareholders. We have information about the creditors. We have information about the suppliers, about the customers. All this information is very important for me. Tomorrow, if I lose this information, it would be a disaster for my company. So, protecting this information is one of the prime responsibilities of information technology. And whether information technology is doing it properly or not, that can be once again checked by auditing. But obviously, audit in an IT environment. Data integration is required to be protected. Data integration means one data is dependent upon another data. That dependency is valid or not. That dependency is working or not. See, if you go for manual accountancy, you prepare a journal. Then you transfer that journal entries into ledger, into trial balance, into final accounts. All these things you do manually. But if you take, for example, a software, an accounting software called as Tally, you just type the journal entries and automatically their final accounts is created. That means the data which is seen in the final accounts is dependent upon the trial balance, which we are not creating. Whatever data is available on in the trial balance, that is dependent upon the ledgers, which once again we are not creating. Okay, so this is nothing but data integration. Data is linked with each and every process. So whether this process of linking, whether this link is working properly or not, checking that is also the responsibility of auditor, obviously working in a IT environment. And then compliance with the law. I have said these things in the past also. When you pay your fees, service tax also you are paying apart from your fees. That is not the property of MT Educare. They have to deposit this service tax in the bank. So government can use it for, I don't know what. Understanding? Getting it? So you have to comply with the law. I'm not sure. This is what just I'm saying. Maybe by 15th of every month, you are required to pay service tax collected in the previous month. That is the requirement of the law, and you have to comply by this law. You have to follow this law. So whether what the law is saying and whether we are complying to those things is being checked by an auditor. We are supposed to pay income tax on time. Suppose you are a manufacturing unit, then you have to pay the export duty. Suppose you are into international trade, you have to pay import and export duty. For everything, law says something. And whether our organization is following it thoroughly or not is been checked by this particular auditing in an IT environment. There was nothing but the introduction of auditing in IT environment. We are now moving to the scope and objectives of auditing in IT environment. What's the scope? Number one, existence. What is existence? Existence means whatever entries are being passed in the books of accounts, were they really existing? Only those things which happen has to be recorded. So it's the work of an auditor to check the existence of each and every entry or each and everything that is mentioned in the legal books, statutory books. Next is called as authorization. Authorization means whether all the things, all the procedures, all the processes were conducted in the same way as the management intended to do. See, parents keep a watch on their children. Rather than saying keep a watch, I should be saying they should be keeping a watch. What children are intended to do, only those things should be done by them. You are supposed to study. You are supposed to go to school, college, class. Are you really doing that? Nani, I'm not asking you whether you are doing that. You are all good students. I know that. I'm just giving you one example. Students are allowed to play. They are authorized to have some free time, they can do some creative things, they are allowed to do some extracurricular activities, but are they doing those extracurricular activities for which they are allowed? So that's nothing but what? That's nothing but authorization. So management has thought something about production, has thought something about marketing, has thought something, had some plans about sales, about collecting capital, about disbursement of money. Whether everything happened according to the intentions of the management, checking that is called as authorization. Then valuation. Valuation is very important in accounting, because accountants tend to overvalue and undervalue the assets. This is what they play. Okay, suppose the profit is very high. I'll have to give it to the shareholders. So my chartered accountant, what he can do is he can show a lesser profit. What I'll be doing simple is I will be showing the lesser value of assets. Machinery worth rupees 13 crores, I'll show the value is only 10 crores. Straight away 3 crores in my pocket. Undervaluing. Now, many a times there is very less profit. Shareholders might question me. They might show mistrust in me. They'll lose trust in me. I'm scared of this. Okay, in the nearby future, I'll cover it. At that point of time, I'll overvalue the assets. I'll show the profit which is not in existence. This is nothing but valuation point. An auditor has to see to it that the value which has been shown in the books of accounts is appropriate. It's not overvalued. It is not undervalued. Cut-off. Cut-off is actually a date within which you are supposed to do your things. Like for registration of IPCC after CPT, there has to be some cut-off date. After that cutoff date, if you go, maybe your form will be accepted with fine. I'm not sure about it, but normally such things happen. And that fine period is also over. After that, you are going and saying, I want to register for IPCC. Will the institute allow? So you are required to do registration in that stipulated period of time. In the same way, the statutory requirements of the company are required to be done in a stipulated period of time before the cutoff date. So it's the responsibility of the auditor to check whether all the requirements, all the transactions, or I would be saying all the formalities are completed before the cutoff date. Next point is called as compliance. Compliance refers to complying with the rules and regulations which are set by the government, or complying with the law which is defined by the government. By the government or certifying authorities. I told you, if you need to have an ISO certification, then you have to comply with the standards set by International Organization for Standards. For manufacturing unit, there is a certification called as GMP, Good Manufacturing Practices. You have to fulfill those conditions. So we need to comply with them. And whether this compliance is done properly, whether this compliance is as per the standard, will be checked by the auditor. Then we have internal control. Internal control means whether all the employees are doing their duty or not. There are some intermediate books, like for example, sales ledger. Now sales ledger has to be updated, purchase ledger has to be updated. Okay, there is a expense book, revenue book, cash book. These are some basic things, whether all these things is happening properly or not. See, suppose you manage your day-to-day activities very well, your ultimate goal will be satisfied very well. You study every day, you will pass in IPCC. So it is all about the basics. So internal control has to be exerted by the auditor. And proper use of computer resources. Proper use of computer resources. Suppose I have a AK-47 with me. It is used for protection of my property. That's the right use. But if I start using that AK-47 to shoot people, then that's the wrong use. Okay, that should be avoided. In the same way, computer resources you have, but that should be used only for the right purpose. So checking whether the computer resources are used for right resources or for right use, that has been done by an auditor. That is nothing but the scope and objectives of auditing in an IT environment. There's a sub-question in auditing in IT environment, and that is audit procedures. In audit procedure, we have to follow the first procedure, that is called as studying the technical aspects. If an auditor is doing auditing in an IT environment, obviously he needs to understand the IT infrastructure, the computer facility. He should be computer literate. He should be knowing some software that helps to do audit on computers. So knowing your computer facility very well. Knowing the application programs very well. You start Tally? Do you think you can start immediately working with Tally? No, or you need to take some knowledge. You should know what is company, what is selecting company, what is shutting company, what is creating company, okay? What is backup, what is restore, what are groups, what are ledgers, what are different types of vouchers, okay? How to prepare a balance sheet, or just there is one button to click. But you should know now where that button is. Understanding? So that is nothing but understanding your application programs very well. Third is knowing the operating procedures. See, computer is doing everything, no doubt about it, but you should know now what is the actual procedure. Then only you can verify whether whatever computer is doing is right or wrong. That's called as knowing your operating procedure. And last but not the least is called as the security procedure. Security procedure means whether all your data is properly secured or not. Whether access control is proper means only authorized persons are accessing the data. Okay, only privileged persons are accessing important data. That is called as partial access. All these things comes under security procedure. Next audit procedure is using unique techniques. I said process development will never die. You need to develop something new. So you need to test your existing software or the existing process and think whether it could be developed. You need to evaluate new computer controls. How can we have better controls on the system? That is called as use unique techniques. And the last is proper use of audit software. In an audit software, whether all the data files are properly situated, whether the contents of that data files is right. You cannot believe software. You need to have a backup. So you have to know some documentation techniques and automated applications are working properly or not. All these things comes under audit procedures. This was the only general topic in chapter 2. Henceforth, I'll be discussing everything about computers. Let me show you a glance of it. Computing and its subdisciplines, server and its types, computer architecture, mobile computing, application software, database management systems, operating systems, computer hardware, data storage devices, system development lifecycle, Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, laptops, tablet, smartphone, and Android. Completely technical. So before, hello, before.
I
We are now moving on with the next question. What is computing? And explain the sub-disciplines of computing. Computing is a very broad term, and n number of terms are involved in computing. Let's try to understand what is computing first. Any process which is converted from any manual process which is converted into a computerized one is always helpful for human beings, am I right? But there has to be a process which will convert this human process or manual process into a computerized one. And that process is called as computing. Now, this is what a layman understands. Something has to be done so that a manual process is converted into a computerized one. So, in broader sense, I would say this is computing. But this is not the answer that is required in the exams. What exactly will write in exams? Computing is a goal-oriented activity which is done with the help of computers. Like for example, I want to automate the tax calculation procedure. I need to automate tax calculation procedure. So what's my goal? To create a tax calculation software or a tax software. But for that, I have to use computers, na? So that particular activity becomes what? Computing. So conversion from a manual system to a computerized one, obviously with the help of computers, with the involvement of computers, by coding, by programming on computers is nothing but computing. Understanding? The most important ingredient in computing is use of computers. There are no computers and now I want to convert a manual system into a computerized one. It is so absurd. I want to have lunch or dinner, but there is no food. Can I have lunch or dinner? No. Understanding? Getting it? That is called as computing. And one more thing, just having hardware is not enough. I need to do some programming. I should know some programming. Okay, so this programming is required to be added. In short, software will be added. Software will be integrated with hardware. And this software will make the hardware run. It will make the hardware work. Then only that particular system is of use for me. Both these things in conjunction with each other is nothing but computing. But I said computing is a very, very, very broad term. Let's try to understand what are its sub-disciplines. Like for example, IPCC. It's a very broad term. You have the aspect of financial management, audit, advanced accountancy, law, information technology, strategic management, tax, direct, indirect tax, taxation, and so on. In the same way, computing is a broad term. It is divided into five sub-disciplines. Number one is called as computer science. What is science basically? Cultivated knowledge. Sir Isaac Newton was sitting below an apple tree. Okay, you know it, na?
No,
sir. Sir Isaac Newton was sitting below an apple tree. Apple fell down and he started wondering why this apple came down. And he developed something called as the law of gravity. Am I right? Now, whenever, we are sitting somewhere, we are walking on the road, okay, and then birds, then we don't sit and think, why did this shit came on me only, why did it came down? We just thanks God, elephant don't fly. Because we know the law of gravity. That is nothing but science. Science is cultivated knowledge. We know all these things. Am I right or wrong?
Yes,
computer science is not. Computer science is nothing but the scientific, or it is also called as the practical approach of computers. It involves almost everything about computers. What is a computer? What are the various aspects in a computer? Okay. So the theoretical part of processing information, of processing data into information, or having the data in a digital format, comes under what? Computer science. In computer science, we understand the design of the hardware, we understand the design of the software, and how to integrate both this hardware and software. Because hardware alone cannot do anything, software alone cannot do anything. Both have to come together, both have to work hand in hand. Am I right or wrong? Okay, that's nothing but the understanding the design of hardware and software. In computer science, we also learn the algorithms, the actual programming constraints which should be implemented so that the data is useful for us. It should be useful for us. Okay, data is of no use. I said Amol 2014 IT, it was of no use for you. Hey, what is this? It's of no use. It is just alphabets, it is just characters, numbers for you. But when the same thing was converted into information, it was useful for you. So it is computer science who understands what is data, and it undertakes some data processing techniques so that this data can be converted into information. That is algorithm for implementation. That's called as computer science. Moving to the next sub-discipline is called as computer engineering. And whenever we all commerce students stay away from the word engineering, because engineering means mathematics. In CPT only we are worried about mathematics. No? If it is no, then actually speaking, you have not seen what is actual mathematics. Mathematics is really a very, very difficult subject. Hey, listen. Listen. Hello. Please wait. आपका जितना उम्र नहीं है ना, उतना साल में मैथमेटिक्स पढ़ चुका है. समझा? Mathematics. Mathematics is really a tough subject. Once you understand it very well, you should have love for that subject. Same is the case with information technology. I know 90% of the students over here hate information. Yeah, information technology. There has to be love for programming. There has to be love for computers. And because all these things do exist in me, I come all the way from Mumbai to teach information technology in Chennai. That is the love for the subject. Now please. Okay. I understood your feelings. Calm down. I was talking about computer engineering. Now computer engineering, obviously, it has evolved with various fields. Let's start with basics. Electrical engineering. Understanding the flow of electricity. Understanding what is live. Understanding what is neutral. Understanding what is earth is very important in electrical engineering. How the electrons move. Where do they move? All these things are important. Then after electrical engineering comes the next stream, and that is called as electronic engineering. Understanding working of a chipset, understanding the flip-flops, all these things comes in engineering. People go for advanced engineering, they go for mechanical, auto, then there are n number of streams. I need not talk about it. Computer engineering is one such part where you learn everything about computers. It is to develop hardware. It's very difficult, huh? Developing hardware. See, I can write program for almost anything, for almost any problem. But if someone asks me to develop a chip which will do this, I cannot do that. I cannot even develop a basic chip. I'm not a person of hardware. Huh, if some basic problem is there of computer, I can repair it. But if there is some major problem, I cannot do anything because I'm not a hardware person. I'm a software person. I can develop program. I can develop a software. That I can do. So computer engineering is all about development of hardware and to some extent software. It involves understanding circuits. It involves understanding processors. It involves understanding motherboards, personal computers, and it goes up up to supercomputer. I'm very, very sure no one person sitting in this classroom must have ever seen a supercomputer. Have you seen it?
No.
I had the privilege of seeing the building of supercomputer. Once for my MCOM, I did my MCOM from Pune University. So I had been in Pune University for registration of MCOM. And there was a blue glass covered two-story building. And it says, Mahasanganak Param Dahahazar. It's written, it's in Marathi. Batatao na, rukna yaar jara. Okay, it was written in Marathi because obviously Pune is in Maharashtra. It says Super Computer Param 10,000. Param 10,000 is an Indian supercomputer and its work is weather forecasting. So it was situated in that Pune University premises and it was all protected by Black Cat Commandos, having high-tech machine guns with them. I was wondering at that building and they said, Hey, chala chala, thambo naka ikde. In Marathi, that was said in Marathi. They said, please don't stand over here. Keep moving. Don't stand. You're not authorized to stand over here. So I saw the building.